Once upon a time, there was a great nation. Now, this nation started small and was surrounded by other great nations around it. But this nation, unlike the other nations, didn't have one God or the other God, its own God to rule over its nation. It had instead the one true God, the Creator God, to help lead them on the way. And it was thanks to their listening to this Creator God that they became not just a small nation, but a great one. And over time, eventually, they had great kings, one in particular who was so wise that all the people came throughout all the nations, kings and queens, the wisest of the wise, to hear what wisdom, a wisdom given to him by the Creator God. They came to hear what wisdom he had to give to them. But over time, the people of the nation decided that they knew what was best, that they knew the ways to follow, that their greatness had come out of their own strength, not from the God that they worshipped, not the one true, the Creator God. And so as they distanced themselves more and more from their Creator God, eventually this nation fell prey to the others around it. And they were taken away from their lands and sent off into other nations. Now, eventually, in their exile, the people of the nation came to understand their need for God. They turned back to God in their exile, and eventually they were allowed to return to their homeland. And so when the people returned to the nation, they swore to themselves that they would never let this happen to themselves again. They would never let themselves fall into the same pattern, the same actions that led them to be exiled. That they would follow what the Creator God had to tell them. They would follow his law as strictly as possible. Now, of course, the nation here is the nation of Israel. And this story, the story that we see unfolding in the Tanakh, or as we call it, the Old Testament, story of the people of Israel, this leads us up to the moment that we see in our gospel this morning. Now, in the gospel, Jesus encounters, as Mark tells us, the Pharisees, or perhaps it would be better for us to say the leaders of the Pharisees. Now, the Pharisees were a sect of the Jewish people, and they were very strict in their following of the law, because they felt that this was how they were going to keep themselves from ever being exiled from their home again. And part of their following the law was to be very strict, to keep the absolute letter of the law. And one of these things was the Sabbath. And that's what we see them come into conflict with Jesus about today. The idea is that you're not supposed to do any work on the Sabbath. And that's what we hear in Deuteronomy this morning. But Jesus, like the Pharisees, like the leaders of the Pharisees, very much wishes for this not to happen, for the people of Israel to continue to be God's people, for them to continue to live in the land which God had given. However, Jesus also realizes that it's not just what the law says that's important, but it's what's behind the law that is important. Because if we go back to what is in Deuteronomy, yes, the command is to rest on the Sabbath. But the point of resting is to remember. It's to remember what God has done for the people of Israel. And more importantly, what is behind that message is that the Sabbath rest is meant to be a time for the people to be in relationship with God. That is the purpose of the Sabbath. And within that purpose as well is holding up the two great commandments, those ways in which we are in relationship with God. And this is what we heard at the very beginning of our service this morning. We are to love God with all our heart, soul, and mind, and that we are to love our neighbors as ourselves. That second part, loving our neighbors as ourselves, is also important in our being in relationship with God. And that's why Jesus does what he does today. Because when he's with his disciples, yes, Jesus could tell them, don't pick off the grain, because that's work. Well, as a matter of fact, in ancient Israel, the fields were constructed just so that the edges of the fields were given for those who had no one, who were poor, who needed help. The point of where the disciples are, where they're picking the grain, is so that they can have sustenance. These people who do not have land, who cannot farm for themselves. They're only doing what they need to eat, to survive, to stay alive. It's not really against the Sabbath purpose for them to be helped. But we see even further in Jesus' own actions that helping others is a key component to the Sabbath. He goes and heals this person on the Sabbath. Not because it's work, not because it's something wrong or anything like that. Jesus does it because it lives out the role of the Sabbath. Purpose being for us to be closer to God. And part of the way we're closer to God is by being closer to each other. Our relationship with each other is intrinsically connected with our relationship with God. The point of the Sabbath is not just to rest. The point of the Sabbath is to be with God, to be in relationship with God, and to be with each other as we do that. The point of all this is that, of course, I want each and every one of you to be here on Sunday, or if you're not here, to be somewhere else, another church community, or even to just listen to what the sermon is, what we're doing online, to have some connection with what the church is doing. But I don't want you to be here, and I don't want you to listen either here or online out of a sense of duty, that this is another check mark that we have to do. Because the point of our worship isn't to be here just because it's another law or something to check off, to do, to make sure we're fulfilled. The point in being is to be with God. The point is to be here with each other as we are being with God. And our whole service is designed to do this. That's why it's important for us to be here, and to let our worship do the work it's supposed to do. Because we're not here just to give our praise. We're not here just to get something. We're here to have this back and forth, to be in relationship to be with God, to be present with God. To do that, we first hear what God has to say to us through the Word. And then we have the part where we're at right now, the sermon. The point of the sermon being is that I've taken the time during the week to listen to what God is saying through His Word. And not just to hear the words of that Word, but to hear what God is still trying to say to each and every one of us through Scripture. Because God is still speaking to us through the words of Scripture. And then after, we hear what God is saying in the past and in the present. Then we give back. We give back our response to them. We offer up our prayers, our concerns, and our thanksgivings to God. We confess our sins. We do those things which bring us back to be with God. We're in relationship with one another through the words of the peace. And then we get into the Holy Eucharist. And it's in that part of the service that we really see this relationship with God work out. Because we're offering the gifts from creation, the bread and the wine. We are offering out of what God has made back to God in the service. As we'll hear in the Eucharistic prayer, we offer up our prayers of praise and thanksgiving to God. And then God is active in this service as well. Because as we ask for the Holy Spirit, we ask the Spirit to come down to sanctify the gifts so that they may be for us the body and blood. And so it's in that action, our action and in God's action, that we become one with Christ Jesus. That through the bread and the wine, we take Jesus into ourselves and become one with Him. Our service, our worship, is designed not to be something we do out of duty, but to be a means for us to be in relationship. Not just with each other, but to be present with the one, the true, the living, and creator God. So we're called not to be like the leaders and Pharisees, to not just look at what the letter of the law is. We're called to go further and deeper, to see what the spirit of the law is, to see what it is that God is trying to have us do. And what that is to be in relationship. The point of our worship is to let it do that work for us, to let it help us to be more present with God. And all we have to do is to show up, to listen, to be present, and to be active, and to let that worship help us to be closer to God, to be with God, to be in relationship.